when he was down, nailed on that cross, the devil should have left him on the ground. Because the Bible said that if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself. You need to hear the truth about the cross. No cross, no salvation. No cross, no deliverance. No death of Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. We do not have what we're saying we're giving him. Grace and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm Mark Crawford, pastor of Christian Family Worship Center. And I am so honored and privileged to be able to bring the Word of God to you today. God has called me to be a pastor and be a preacher. And so today, I'm going to bring the Word of God to you. As you come with us into one of our services here at Christian Family Worship Center, I do not believe this is an accident that you tuned in, but this is a divine appointment between you and God. Open your heart, open your mind, open your ears. I believe God will fill your heart and will change your life today. God bless you. Enjoy the service. We need to do the works of Jesus. Doing the works of Jesus. Amen. Healing, cleansing, casting out. Amen. He even said in one place, we'll raise the dead. Woo! Glory to God. Your life can change. Your life can change. Amen. God is able. Sure.
I was sitting in the back of the church this morning, and I was just looking around, and I got to thinking. I work two jobs. I work, I'm a security manager at the casino, and I'm a police officer in Bunkie. And the biggest sin that I see, I mean, I see sins every day. The biggest sin I see is racism. And I thank God that I can come to a church where there isn't any racism.
Come on.
I thank God that I can do this.
Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Have your way, God. Can I tell on you for a little bit? You know, that's God working in his life. As well, God wants to make some changes in the world. You know, I was in here praying at 3:30 in the morning. I prayed half the night. And you know, if you've been part of this ministry since its beginning, get that bottle of oil before I trip on it, one of you guys. I just saw that, and I'm not going to see that. And God has taken us a long way, but there's a long way yet to go. And as I came in here last night, I sat down. And you got to understand that I watched as we built this thing. Almost every screw put in, every joint of sheetrock, and I mean, every part, just painting and... See, some of y'all don't know that there's a Bible right here under the slab, right under this pulpit. And there's a Bible in each door that every time you walk through the doors, you're walking on the Word of God. That in this altar area, that in the slab, there's healing scriptures from one end to the other that were printed and put into the slab that I wanted to build this ministry on the truth of the Word of God. And I sat here and I said, Lord, I want this pulpit, this place where declarations go forth to be dedicated and committed to truth. Not presumption. Not speculation. Not white agendas or black agendas or Hispanic agendas. See, white people are not our problem. Black people are not our problem. The Mexican people are not our problem. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. And he's worked in the midst of that to try to divide us. And that's why on a Sunday morning, we're more segregated than any other time in America. And we call churches a white church or a black church depending on the color of the pastor or the color of the congregation. Well, it's supposed to be the church of Jesus Christ. And for us to dedicate this ministry, this pulpit, the proclamations of what goes forth to the truth, not everyone's going to like it. They don't like the truth. They like to argue their agenda. The truth is not something that we make up or we just feel is true. The truth is a person. His name is Jesus Christ. And his word is truth. And if you ever want to be free, the only way you're ever going to be free is to know the truth. And the truth will make you free. So, you know, sometimes we get up and we say things, preachers, pastors, myself, and we say things out of our hurts, out of our pains, out of our experiences. And when we do that, we're actually not presenting the truth to the people. And again, I was sitting right here just praying. And I told God, I said, Lord, I dedicate this pulpit, this ministry and the voice of this ministry to proclaiming truth. Then I said, I'm dedicating myself to proclaiming the truth. I'm dedicating my eyes to look upon that which is true. My ears to be open to hear that which is true. My life to be wanting the truth. And whenever it's not the truth, that I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to embrace it. I'm not going to walk in it. I'm not going to play the blame game anymore. Because if I'm having trouble in my life, it's because of my choices. Oh, there's been a lot of injustice, and there still will be a lot of injustice done. But you got to get up, and you got to get a hold of Jesus Christ, and you got to move forward, forgetting those things that are behind. Pressing forward for those things that are ahead. Amen. You know, America put all of its eggs in a basket called education, thinking that education was going to deliver us out of racism. I want you to know education has not succeeded to deliver our nation from its racism. So we build more prisons. We hire more policemen. We make more laws. We need to embrace the truth. That it's not a white gospel. It's not a Hispanic gospel. It's not a black gospel. It's not a female gospel. It's not a male gospel. It's the gospel of Almighty God. The gospel of Jesus Christ that changes the hearts of people. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. I want you to go with me to 1 Corinthians right now, the chapter 13. We've been talking about love. Say love. Now, how many of you know that God is love? And it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So the Word of God is love, isn't it? If God is love and God is His Word, then we realize that the Word of God is love. So when God speaks His Word to you, when truth comes to you, I want you to know that truth is trying to love you, not hurt you. So when you hear the truth, it's love. It's the love of God reaching out to you. You know, you're in a bad place when you're so hard to God, you can't even hear the truth anymore. Amen. Now the truth. Do you realize that truth doesn't change? Even if a million people say that the lie is true, it's still a lie. Now, we just this week found out that California is going to allow same-sex marriages. It's legal now. Now, just because it's a law, does that make it true? Where do you determine where truth comes from? From the preacher? From the Word, because there's some preachers that preach against what the Word of God says. Now, I love all people. Regardless of the color of their hair, the color of their skin, or their sexual orientation. But I tell you what, and regardless of their size. Amen. But do you know that we could still be in sin? How many of you know gluttony is a sin? We don't want to talk about that. We want to talk about the drug addicts, but we don't want to talk about the, you know, the ones who buff the buffet. So sin is sin, and we kind of categorize it. We put homosexual sin on a higher level than we would put heterosexual sin. But the truth is that you're not supposed to have sex unless you're married, regardless of your orientation. So now they're going to try to say we're going to get married and redefine the family. But then you got to keep reading about what sodomy is and homosexuality and other parts of what the Scripture says. You can't twist the Scripture to your own destruction. Come on. Now I'm trying to tell you what the truth is. Now if you love the truth, when you hear the truth, and you let that truth become part of your life, the truth will make you free. But what we've done now is that we've got this thing where we kind of have pointed our fingers at the homosexuals, and we have not pointed our finger back at the heterosexual people that are having sex and they're not married. Not understanding that all of it is sexual immorality, regardless of what your orientation is. Amen. The truth. Do you really want the truth? Come on, do y'all really want the truth? Where are you going to find it? Now, in this chapter of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, y'all know this is the love chapter. Amen. And he talks about love, and it's one of the greatest chapters on love that you, I mean, it is the greatest chapter on love, in my opinion, in the entire Scripture, explaining love. But then he comes down, and look at verse 11. I want us to look at verse 11 today, where it says, "When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things." Now, when does a person become a man? Is it the age 12? Is it the age 15? Is it 20? 25? I know some people that are 50 years old and they still think like a child, act like a child. Their understanding is still like a child. They have not become a man yet. Age has nothing to do with it. There are some 14-year-old people that are more mature than some of you 50-year-old people. What determines if you're a man is if you have finally decided to put away the childish ways of thinking, the childish ways of living. When are we going to grow up and understand
that a man embraces truth, lives by the truth, attempts to have a life of integrity and honor, and his word is his word. And when he stands in the altar and he says, until death do us part, for better, for worse, I'm going to be your provider, your protector. I'm going to take upon myself every responsibility of a Christian husband. That he means what he says when he stands in the altar. And he doesn't go fooling around. He doesn't go drugging and drinking every night. Because he's not a child anymore. He's a man. And that goes for women too. When we talk about man, we're talking about a mature person, male or female. Come on, ladies. When are you going to put away the childish things? Put away the Barbie doll? The crack? The drugs? The racism? That's a childish thing. To think that the color of someone's skin makes them any better than someone else. That's a childish thing. I want us to grow up. When I was a child, I acted like a child. I played games all the time. We built tree houses. We played rabbit. We didn't have video games except that one that would just do beep, beep, beep. And that was so slow, we just played ping pong ourselves. We just got us the table and the net and we played ping pong. But you know, there came a day whenever I had to put away childish things. Had to get a job. Had to supply my needs. Had to buy a house. You know, by the time I was 20 years old, I owned my own house. Do you realize that? I'd found me a job. I had gotten me a trade. I was making money. I bought me a car. I had me a house. When I married Mary, I didn't have to go look for a house. We already had a house. We didn't move in with mom and dad. Come on. See, grow up. Turn to your neighbor and say, grow up. But you know what's happened? We're losing a generation back over here. We're losing a whole generation. The ones coming behind us, they don't even understand what I'm talking about. There was an older generation that was an example. That would stand up and say, if you want to succeed, this is how you succeed. And you know, back then, God was part of our lives. God was put in the schools. God was spoken about. Whenever I was in elementary school, whenever the ambulance would pass or you'd hear a siren, our teacher would stop and say, let's pray because someone is hurt. Let's ask God to bless them and help them. And compassion was released in my heart. And I felt compassion for someone that was in trouble. And the teacher would pray a prayer in the classroom. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Because that's who she knew to pray to. And then now we take prayer out of the classrooms and we wonder why our children are violent. They don't even know what compassion is. Because compassion originates with God, my friends. It doesn't originate just in a human heart without God. Go with me to Matthew 4:4. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. In reviewing what we taught on Wednesday night this week, powerful scripture. Matthew 4:4. This is after Jesus had fasted for 40 days. He was in the wilderness, and the devil had tempted him. And he answered and he said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now I want you to think about that for a minute. What does it mean whenever Jesus said, man does not live by bread alone? He doesn't live just by the natural means, not just by material things. It's not material. See, someone that lives by bread alone, it's materialism. They take the spiritual dimension out of their lives. Man cannot live a successful, godly life without God. Man does not live by bread alone. And see, what our society is doing is taking God out of everything and saying, you know what, we don't need God, we're going to live by bread alone. But I want you to know, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word. Say every word. Every word. Say it again, every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We don't pick and choose what is true and not true. Every word of God is true. You say, well, I don't believe that part. I think that was for that time. Now we're in a new age and we have new understanding. No, it's either all true or it's not true. Man does not live by the natural world or by the natural means, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. How many of y'all pick up this Bible enough to read it from one end to the other to begin to know what every word of God is? He wrote it down so that you would have it. And let me tell you, it didn't say man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that angels speak to them in the night. Be careful, those people who say, angels are telling me to tell you this. You better make sure whatever's being said lines up with this right here. Because you'll be in trouble. You'll be way out in left field following some goofy person. The angel of the Lord came to me last night and told me that all of y'all are to sell everything you have and come follow me. That's stupid. And some people do it. They follow people. Somebody gets up and says, I want y'all to know, I'm the Messiah. Oh, yeah? I got a swimming pool right in the back. Come walk across it. Beware, the Bible says, of all these false prophets and false teachers in the last days. That's what he says. Beware. Now, I do believe there are angels. There's angels in here right now. We see how they ministered to the people in the New Testament. But I tell you what, if they ever say something to you, if something appears to you, from the spirit realm, you're supposed to test the spirit. That's what you're supposed to do. First thing you're supposed to ask them, did Jesus Christ come in the flesh? Not, oh, you look glorious and you're real big. The devil comes as an angel of light. First thing you ask, did Jesus come in the flesh? Do you believe Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the whole world? And then everything they say better line up with what's in this book. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I've been teaching about this cycle. You remember I said, here we are, and we get into this circle where we keep saying we're going to change, and we find ourselves right back around where we are. And whenever you're going in the circle, you're basically lost. But you're not too lost because you keep finding yourself. But you need to find the truth. And then I talked about how this kind of makes like a vortex like this. And when you start going in a circle, you keep going and going and you find yourself down and you feel like you're trapped down here. Well, when you're down here and you keep resisting the truth and you don't know God, you're living by bread alone. This is someone that just lives by bread alone. And the only thing that can deliver you out of this trap is a word from God. All you need is a word from God. But you've got to respond to that word from God. You've got to believe that it's a word from God. You've got to receive that word from God. And you've got to act upon the word of God. And that's when you know the truth and the truth will set you free. So when you hear a word from God, that word lifts you up and then gets you back on track. And your journey is home. God wants us to get home. Now, what is home? See, most people say heaven. I tell you what, it's not. Our goal today is not heaven. Our goal today is to have an intimate relationship with God. Heaven is automatic when you've got an intimate relationship with God. But if you just want your ticket to heaven and you don't want to live an intimate relationship with God, you get your ticket, you know, you say, I believe in Jesus Christ, and then you stay down here all your life. And everybody in your life is being destroyed all around you. But I believe in Jesus. I believe in Jesus. I pray the sinner's prayer. I'm going to go to heaven. But while I'm living down here, I have no relationship with God whatsoever. Go with me to the book of John, chapter 14, verse 6. Very, very familiar portion of Scripture. We hear it all the time. Jesus says right here to him, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Say the Father. So the goal of life is to have an intimate relationship with the Father. That's why we talk about, do you have religion or a relationship with God? Whenever we talk about Christianity, do you see a church or do you see a heart that's in union with Jesus Christ that knows the Father? What do you see? What is your goal? Get your ticket to heaven or to live a life with an intimate relationship with God on a daily basis? Now listen to what Jesus said. He says, I am the way. So this right here, that is Jesus. He is the road. He is the agape road. He is the Word of God made flesh, isn't he? He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So truth is not a concept. Truth is a person. Jesus Christ. Why did Jesus come? He came to introduce us to the Father. He wants us to renew our relationship with God because our relationship with God had been broken through sin. But if we live by bread alone, we're materialistic. We embrace the philosophies of this world. We let what the world says about life rule us instead of what the Word of God says about life. We become these self-made, self-help people. Amen. I like this one. When you live by bread alone, you become the victim. You blame everybody for everything. Instead of understanding that you have victory in Jesus Christ. When you live by bread alone, you'll become a predator. Because you'll try to get whatever you can from anybody else. You can be the very opposite of a predator. You can be a parasite. You know, the statistics say that 10% of the people in your life want to suck the life out of you and not give you any life. They're not interested in you living a happy life and having joy. They're interested in pointing out everything you do wrong and trying to suck the joy out of life. 10% of the people in your life are like that. Y'all probably could think about a couple of them right now. Now, what happens whenever you suck in your own joy out? Boy, you're in bad shape when you get up and you can't even enjoy your own life looking at yourself. Wow. They get lonely. When you live by bread alone, you'll be lonely. Then you'll compromise on the Word to try to have companionship, and you'll have sinful relationships. You'll be fearful, and you'll be angry because you're not getting the satisfaction you need in your heart. But Jesus came that we may have life, and what? Life more abundantly. He sent His Word to deliver us out of our troubles. But how many of y'all spend any time in this Word? Is it just what you hear me preach is all you get? You're not getting enough if all you're getting is what you hear me preach. You need to open up the book and begin to read it. And begin to say, Lord, teach me, show me the truth. Lead me and guide me. Amen? So where is home? Heaven? No, home is our relationship with our Father. When I'm with my Father, I'm at home. So heaven is for when I die. I believe in heaven, okay? But that's where I'm going when I die. Anybody going to heaven with me? You don't have to come right when I go, but you're going to meet me in heaven? All right? That's where you're going to go when you die, because you believe in Jesus and what he did for you on the cross. So that's your destination. But your journey is to live an intimate relationship with God. Whenever I blow it, whenever I sin, whenever I act outside the character of God, I don't immediately say, oh my God, I'm afraid I'm going to go to hell. I get convicted because I've been separated from God, and I realize that what I did was not pleasing to my Father, and all of a sudden my relationship with my Father is in jeopardy, and that intimacy is gone. And it's not because he went anywhere, it's because I went somewhere. And I go repenting, not because I'm afraid of hell, it's because I want to renew my relationship with the Father. What is the first and greatest commandment of all? To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. It's talking about a loving, intimate relationship with God. And then to love one another as we love ourselves, or as Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you. And there's no greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his neighbor, for his brother. We begin to act like Jesus, live like Jesus. So we need a word from God. So I want to ask you, are you willing to give up your harp and your cloud, your heavenly paradise mentality for an intimate relationship with God? Or is it only about getting to heaven? I'll tell you, Jesus said, when I teach you to pray, I want you to pray like this: Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So while we're still in the earth, we are to be manifesting the kingdom of God in our lives, in our families. Listen, if we're going to love God with all our hearts, I'll be able to love my wife with all my heart. Amen? I mean, this is the way a marriage is supposed to be. You've got the husband, you've got the wife, and you've got God. And if you love God, guess what's going to happen? His heart will be made whole, her heart will be made whole, and they'll have a whole heart to give to each other. And when you love God, you know, husband, when you goof up? Wives, you know when your husbands goof up? Y'all can say amen. They didn't say amen. When you goof up, you know God will forgive you. Wife, you know when you goof up, you know what? God will forgive you. So wife, when you goof up, you know your husband will forgive you because he wants God to forgive him. And vice versa. How many of you know you need forgiveness in a marriage? Come on. If you're married, you know you really need forgiveness in a marriage. Because I know I do. Woo, sometimes I just don't act like I'm supposed to act. She's right. She's right. But you know she doesn't act like she's supposed to all the time either. Amen. Now you're supposed to say, he's right. We will know the truth will make us free. So, listen, guys, don't be striving to get to heaven. That's what religion has done to us. They put the fear of hell and this thing of heaven, and then they give us all these rules that we got to try to keep, and we hope that when we die we might slip on into heaven, without realizing that whenever you trust in Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ is the way. Amen. And that if you're in him, it says, he who has the Son of God has life. I'm not trying to get life. I have life. And he says, and you can know that you have eternal life because you have the Son of God. But I'm still on this journey, this road right here. And when I'm on this road, this is what I got to be careful of. And I've learned this as I've been a Christian for years. I'm on this journey home, okay? But then I'm going on this journey, and I start to veer off, and I start that hook again over here. And I try to reach God on my own, and I try to become religious instead of having a relationship with the Father. Or I go the other route. I get where I start to be tempted by my lust and the things of my flesh, and I get down here in the world. Either way, I got to leave these concepts. And one Wednesday night, I showed y'all that whenever we put the kingdom first, it says that seek first the kingdom of God and all the other things will be added unto you. So the riches and the things of this world, the things the Gentiles seek after, clothing and all those things, and he talks about that in that portion of Scripture. He said if you seek first the kingdom, God gives those to you and they're proper. They're in their proper place. But if we seek first the riches of the world, and we'd make our bullseye off target. Well, the kingdom falls in there, but the kingdom's not first place. So everything that is before the kingdom is an idol. It's a god, and you'll see, he said, I'll have no other gods before me. I'm a jealous God. My name is jealous. And so we got to refocus and get this thing right. So when we seek first the kingdom and that relationship with the king, then everything else is going to fall in its place and it won't destroy you. Amen? And I showed you that we also get off on our target when we target our religion instead of our relationship. And again, the kingdom falls outside of that. And we do all of our rules and our regulations and all of our other things, and we think that we're going to earn our way to heaven. We're missing the mark because we're saved by faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. Through grace. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Y'all understand that? So our destination is a daily goal where we live in a close, intimate relationship with God. That means we live by the truth. Amen. Jesus is the only way home. See that road right here? That's Jesus. He's the only way. Jesus is the agape road. Jesus is the Word made flesh. Heaven is a gift from God, but our goal is not heaven. Heaven is our destination. Our goal is to be introduced to the Father. Let me ask you, do you know the Father today? I want you to know the Father today. I wrote these things down. When we die, we're going to go to heaven. But when we live, we should live and love God, our Father. That's what worship is. No, people who don't understand worship, they don't understand an intimate relationship with God. Getting on the road is easy. How many of y'all know that? Believing and getting on the road is easy. But staying on the straight and narrow path takes a little bit of effort. It takes this word called discipline. How many of y'all like that word, discipline? We don't like discipline. In other words, to stay on the road and never veer off to the world or get caught up in religious things is to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ. Disciple means a disciplined follower of Jesus. How disciplined are you to read His Word on a daily basis? How disciplined are you to fast and to pray? How disciplined are you to make decisions based upon the truth? How disciplined are you to resist the temptations of the world? The sexual temptations. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. God desires to restore our relationship to Him. That's number one. That's loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Why? Because when that relationship is restored, you're going to connect to the source of all healing, the source of all life, the source of all prosperity, and all the other things will be added unto you. You need to seek first your relationship in the kingdom of God, your right standing with God, then everything else is going to be added unto you, is what He promised. And He's not a liar. In the book of Romans in chapter 8, you can turn there, verse 28. This is what Jesus says about all the junk that we've gone through to get to where we are. This is the word of God given to Paul. So I'm saying when Jesus said, I know it's God's word, he says this. He says, for we know that all things work together for the good, for them that love God, and to them who are called according to his purpose. So whatever's been going on in your life, it doesn't matter how much your life has blown up to this point. If you'll just say, I'm going to love God. See, to love the Lord your God, that intimate relationship with God. He says, I'm going to cause all of that junk, all of those things that happen, to work together for the good. Now, that's not my promise. That's his promise. To those who love God, now, not to everybody. The world is not working for their good. You've got to be a lover of God, a lover of the truth. Amen. See, God and the truth are the same. And you also got to embrace the purpose for your creation. God created you with a purpose. To those who are called according to his purpose. There's a purpose for you to be who you are. Why were you created? What is your destiny? I'm not talking about destination heaven. But what is your journey of life going to bring you through? What is going to be your legacy? Charles talked about that last week. What is going to be the legacy of your life? I was a child. I lived my life as a child. I played as a child. I did everything as a child because life is all about having fun. And I came to the end of my life, and so I have the date I was born, my dash, and the date I died, and at the bottom we ought to put on your gravestone, and he was a child all of his life. Or she was a child all of her life. Because we did not see the big picture of why we're in the world. To make a difference in people's lives. This pulpit is dedicated to making a difference in your life. This man is dedicated to making a difference in your life. That's why I'm preaching this word to you. And we need to wake up out of this childishness and slumber. And realize that we need to grow up and embrace the destiny that God has for us. Boy, I'm preaching a lot better than y'all saying amen. Because I'm preaching to me too. When you go into this world and you're going to love, see, it says love God. If you love God, you love others. Loving others means you live the truth. When you see something unjust being done, you stand up and say, that's unjust. You should not do that. You say, well, I might make some enemies. So what? Jesus made so many enemies, they all wanted to crucify him. They killed him and he was manifest love. But it was unjust. But listen how he ends this. I didn't turn there. But he says that for all of us to be... I need to turn there because I want to read that to you. The next scripture in chapter 8. I knew the other one by heart. Verse 29. She could have put it up there, huh? For whom he foreknew. That means he already knew all your junk. He already knew all what he was going to do, all what was going to happen. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined. What? To be conformed to the image of his son. So God is, if you'll love God, he'll cause all of this stuff to work to fix you. Because you know what happened with sin in your life? It broke your image. You were supposed to be like Jesus, but we're broken. We're a broken image of a reflection of God. But he says, you know what? If you'll love me and let my purpose work in your life, he says, I'm going to restore you to your proper image. To be like Jesus. I foreknew you. Already knew all this was going to happen. And this is a statement that you may agree with or not agree with, but I'm going to say it anyway. Can you dare to believe that nothing touches your life without the Father's permission? Whatever has touched your life, God has allowed it. He didn't cause it. I didn't say he caused it. Our decisions usually cause it, but he allowed it. And he promised in his word that if you'll start loving him and get a hold of your destiny, your purpose, he said, I'll make all of that junk work together for the good. So he can take a Bayou Blanc and set him up on a pulpit to declare truth and speak on a television and with a possible 17,000 people watching this broadcast. Amen. How did he do that? He's God. And I'm not. And I realize I'm not. So if anybody gets changed, it's because of your response to God. If anybody gets healed, it's not because of me. It's because of your response to the truth. Amen. Jacob, would you come forward? You can close your Bibles. Go ahead and put up on the screen Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28. Put your stuff down. Did y'all get anything out of this today? Give God praise then, yes. In Matthew in chapter 11 and verse 28, Jesus says these words, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden." You see, he didn't say, "Come to me, all of you that have done so well and so good. All of you good boys and girls, you now can come to me because you've been good enough." No, he reaches out to the ones who need. Amen. He says, "Come to me, those of you that are worn out, tired, bruised and beaten up by the world. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." I've been teaching that therefore remains a rest for the people of God. But you've got to mix the Word of God with faith. You've got to respond to that Word. He says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." You know, Jesus wants to teach you himself. So when you wake up tomorrow morning, when you go to bed tonight, and you open up his Word, and you say, "Lord Jesus, I've taken your yoke. I want to learn from you." You begin to read it, guess what he's going to do? He's going to begin to teach you. He's going to lead you, guide you. He says, "For I am gentle and lowly in heart." Now sometimes the preacher sounds a little not so gentle, but he's gentle. "And you will find rest for your soul." Anybody needs a rest on the inside of them? "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Come to Jesus today. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, I want to invite you to give your life to Jesus. I'm not asking you to join this church. I'm not asking you to join a religion or leave a religion. I'm asking you to come to Jesus.
I want to thank you today for joining us for this broadcast. I believe that you've heard the Word of God and that that Word can change your life. I know that many of you that are watching right now are suffering with many things. Some are suffering physically with sickness and disease. Some of us suffer mentally with depression and oppression. Some of us are suffering financially. We've lost jobs. We've been bankrupt. Many pressures of the world come. I want to pray for you today. I want to pray that God would just bring peace to your heart and begin to change the circumstances of your life. So join with me right now as I pray and believe God for a miracle in your life, a change in your life. Heavenly Father, I pray for all of those that are watching right now on television, that are in the sound of my voice, that you by your Holy Spirit will touch them right now and bring healing to their bodies, peace to their minds, restoration to what's been stolen away. Father, open doors that they'll have new jobs. Open doors that their finances would be able to meet the needs that they have. We're not asking to be extravagantly rich, Lord God. We're asking you to just meet the needs today. To heal the sick today that are watching on television. To heal the broken marriages today, Lord God. To heal the broken minds and the oppressed and the depressed, that the joy of the Lord once again would come into their life. So Lord, touch those that are watching right now on television. In Jesus' name. Do a miracle. Those of you that are watching right now, believe and receive and touch God with your faith and say, "God, today is the day I believe for my turnaround." You need to say that to God. "Today is the day I believe you for a turnaround." God bless you. Now, I would just love to hear testimonies of things that God has done through what we just prayed and asked God to do. It's not only my faith that takes your faith, but our faith together can move mountains, is what Jesus said. But you know what? Those natural miracles are nothing to compare to the miracle of salvation. If you have not made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, you need to ask Him today to be the Lord of your life. Say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I believe You died on the cross for me, that You was buried and that God raised You from the dead. I believe in the resurrection. And I ask You today to be my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart and into my life. In Jesus' name, amen. See, give your life to Jesus because Jesus wants to give His life to you. I want to thank you again for allowing me to speak into your heart the Word of God. It is such a privilege for me to be part of this community and share God's Word with you. God bless you. Come visit us. I hope to see you soon. And remember, God knows everything about you and loves you anyway.
with open heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Oh, let the ancient words
healing rain is coming down, is coming nearer to this old town. The rich and poor, the weak and strong, it's bringing mercy, it won't be long. Healing rain is coming down, it's coming closer to the lost and found. Tears of joy and tears of shame are washed forever in Jesus' name. Healing rain, take us high.